And fine twined linen of cunning work with cherubim shall it be made. And thou shalt hang it upon four pillars of shittim wood overlaid with gold. Their hooks shall be of gold upon the four sockets of silver. And thou shalt hang up the veil under the taches, and thou mayest bring in thither within the veil the ark of the testimony. And the veil shall divide unto you between the holy place and the most holy. So this veil that we're reading about here is a thick, strong curtain of fine twined linen, pure white, decorated with the colors of blue, purple, and scarlet, hanging there outside the Holy of Holies, with the altar of incense and the table of showbread and the golden lampstand on one side and the Ark of the Covenant on the other side. And what we seen last Sunday was that this veil signified, according to the book of Hebrews, that the way into the holiest was not made manifest yet, meaning that the way to God was not open as of yet. But then we know from the Gospel of Matthew chapter 26, when the Lord Jesus Christ died there upon the cross of Calvary, that veil was torn in two from top to bottom. And if that veil, when it was hanging there, draping down, separating the holy place from the Holy of Holies, if that signified a barrier there from one going into the presence of God, now, once it's been torn, we can plainly see what that signifies, and it's simply the truth that the way to God now is open and clear. The Holy Spirit interpreted what the veil represented there in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19, when it said, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which He hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, His flesh. When Christ died upon the cross, when He laid down His life as a sacrifice for us, He cried, "It's finished." And when He gave up the ghost, that veil representing the way being blocked, representing Christ's flesh there, once His flesh has been torn and broken for the purpose of the New Testament, that veil of the house of God signifying through the tearing of His flesh signified now the way is open to God. And that's the message there. We can enter now into the presence of God by faith with real assurance by the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, the last message I highlighted for you, just to teach you the record of God's Word there, the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ, as if to be able to highlight the ministry of Jesus Christ and lay it down over the blueprint of that tabernacle. Because for sure that's what we have there. We look at the tabernacle, and if you study much about it, you'll find out that it is a means by which we can study in our approach to God. Many times that's exactly the thought of which we attach to the tabernacle, our approach to God, our drawing nigh to God there as far as the layout of the tabernacle is concerned. But we have to realize that before we can approach God, before we could ever make our way towards God, He had to come our way. He had to initiate this fellowship. He had to initiate this relationship. After all, the Bible says, we love Him because He first loved us. And that's the way this works. So that there's two ways then to view the Old Testament tabernacle. One is our approach to God, and then the other is Him bringing salvation to us. Bringing many sons to glory is how it's stated in the book of Hebrews. Now we understand first, as we're going to approach God, we remember there is the brazen altar there at the door, at the entrance of the tabernacle going into the outer place. And there at the entrance of this tabernacle in the outer court, there is this brazen altar, this altar of sacrifice. It's brass because brass represents God's judgment upon sin. And then the fire raises up off of that altar of sacrifice representing God's divine nature. Our God is a consuming fire. God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. And as sin comes into contact with the holiness of God, it burns. And there in as they enter into the tabernacle, a picture of you and I going towards God, the first thing we would be shown is that before we can go any further towards the presence of God, our sins first have to be taken care of. You can't get close to God until your sins are taken care of. And that's a picture of salvation. You have to be born again. Sin has to be atoned for. And there at the cross of Calvary, that's what happened. Sin was atoned for. The holiness of God came down in judgment against the sin of men. And listen, the Bible says in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. Jesus Christ was the Lamb of God without sin. He became sin. He was made to be sin, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. And so that we could get to God, He came down in human flesh to bring us to God. And He offered Himself there according to the will of God upon that altar of Calvary. There, that picture of the brass altar of sacrifice. Now, once your sins are taken care of, you go past that, there's the brass laver. And brass, again, represents God's judgment on sin, but this time it's not a judgment of fire. See, your sins are taken care of at Calvary. But now, once we're there and we're going towards God, our sins being taken care of, we still need to be daily cleansed. And what's represented there, of course, is our relationship with God through the Word of God. We look into the perfect law of liberty, and what we see is we see ourselves just like that brazen laver had those mirrors there at the foot. They would look down and they would wash themselves and they would cleanse themselves. They seen their own reflection. That's what happens when you and I, on a daily basis, go to the Word of God with an honest heart and a prayerful attitude. We go there. The Word of God reveals to us our shortcomings, reveals to us our motives, reveals to us our sin. And as a result, we're able to confess our sin. And He is faithful and just to forgive us our sin in the way of having fellowship with Him. And we're able to get clean. Even after our sins are taken care of, we still need that daily cleansing so that we can walk with God and have fellowship with God. And until the believer begins to practice that daily, they're not going to go any closer to God. Your sins have to be taken care of. That is, you've got to be saved. Then once you're saved, you've got to learn daily to take care of the defilement that comes just from being in the flesh and just from being in the world from day to day. Then once we get past that, what will take place is you get into the holy place, and there on our right, as you was going that direction, there on my right would be the golden table of showbread. And that would picture God inviting us to His table for fellowship. And that would represent, of course, you and I sitting down with the Lord, drawing nigh to God, being sustained upon both the carnate Word of God and the incarnate Word of God. Having our souls fed and nourished by the person of Jesus Christ through the reading of the Scriptures and studying doctrine, just as Jesus said. He said, learn of Me. He said, search the Scriptures. For in them you think you have eternal life, and these are they which testify of Me. When He made that statement, He was referring to the Old Testament record, and He was saying to you and I as New Testament believers, go back and look at that record, and you'll see I'm all the way through there. And as we sit down and we begin to look for Jesus in the Old Testament record, we begin to have fellowship with God, and it's a matter of drawing nigh to God. But then, not only is there that sense of nourishment, God also says, walk in the light as He is in the light. And there's that golden lampstand over there that represents you and I walking in that obedience, because God's Word is a lamp to our feet, it is a light to our path, and drawing nigh to God involves that illumination that comes from the Spirit of God in His words. Then there's the altar of incense. The altar of incense there. It has that censer. That censer lights those fragrances and lights that oil there in that altar of incense, so that sweet savor goes throughout the holy place. And God in His presence can enjoy the fragrance of the sweet incense from off the altar of incense. And there's only one way to light that altar of incense in the way of worship and God. And that is to take the fire from off of the sacrifice, the brass altar of sacrifice, and bring the coals and the fire from off that altar where the sacrifice was made, and worship God based upon the fire off of that altar. That's the only way you can worship God there. Folks, that's you and I. You and I are standing before God. Our worship and service before God is based upon the sacrifice made 2,000 years ago in the person of Jesus Christ. Paul said, God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me and I unto the world. It all starts with Calvary, folks, and everything we do to please God must go through Calvary. And then there's the veil. And behind that veil, there's the Ark of the Covenant. And above the Ark of the Covenant, above the mercy seat, there's the invisible manifest presence of God dwelling between those cherubim. Again, there's a layout for us and understanding what must be done in our Christian life in approaching God. But again, I'll say this. We can't start His way until He first came our way and opened the way to God. Yeah. He had to open the way that we might approach Him, and that's something the Spirit of God would have us to see, because in the layout of the tabernacle and its furniture, it doesn't start with our approach to God. As He begins to tell them how to make the tabernacle, if it was our approach to God, He would start with that brass altar of sacrifice. But when He begins to instruct them on how to build the tabernacle, you know where He starts? He don't start on the outside going in. He starts in the Holy of Holies going out. Amen. He starts with the Ark of the Covenant first. Because salvation isn't you and I getting up to God. It's God coming down to us. Yeah. Salvation came from God. It's not you and I working our way up to Him. Amen. He had to open the way up for us to be able to get to God. And that's another view there of this matter of the layout of the tabernacle. Not just our approach to God, but first and foremost, what He did, highlighting in His ministry as He came down here, as the Bible says, describing His mission to bring many sons unto glory. So that you and I could get to God, He first had to come our way and make the way possible, make it open to where we could do that. Now, first, within the Holy of Holies, there's God. He's above the universe, and He's highly exalted. And the one who's with God, according to John chapter 1, the one who was with God in the beginning is the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In Him was life, and in Him dwelled the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And that's represented there by that Ark of the Covenant there that contained the tables of stone, Aaron's rod that budded, and the pot of manna. Showing the Lord there as the living God, showing the Lord as the gracious God, and showing Him there in His authority as the Lord over all. That's what's represented in the Ark of the Covenant. Now He goes from the Holy of Holies coming our way, because you and I are on the outside looking in. And what does He do? He has to go by the veil. And what did the Bible say? The Bible said the veil was His flesh. You see, in order for Him to come and accomplish what God had sent Him to accomplish, He had to veil Himself, veil His glory in a human body. And He became every bit as human as you and I. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10 verse 5, it says, "Wherefore when He cometh into the world," this is Him leaving the Holy of Holies now, "when He cometh into the world, He saith, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared for me. In burnt offering and sacrifices for sin, thou hast had no pleasure. Then said I, lo, I come, in the volume of the book it is written of me, to do thy will, O God." And as the Bible says, the Word was made flesh. His eternal glory was veiled in that human body, and leaving the Holy of Holies, Christ came down from heaven to earth, from the Father above, to do His will, and He was in the world. The world was made by Him, and the world knew Him not. And with only a small amount of information we get from the Gospel of Luke about His birth, and He is becoming a newborn, and then a two-year-old child there in the Gospel of Matthew, and a 12-year-old child there in the Gospel of Luke, the Scriptures immediately jump in all four counts to the beginning of His public ministry. And He appears there at the baptism of John the Baptist, numbered with the transgressors waiting in line to be baptized by John the Baptist, who's preaching that baptism of repentance there. And then one comes to be baptized, who John says, "You ought to be baptizing me." He says, "I'm not worthy to baptize you." And yet He comes to be baptized. And there the Spirit of God comes down upon Him, signifying His stop at what? His stop at the altar of incense. Because there is that sweet incense there in the outer court there, or the holy place on the other side of the veil. As that sweet incense would go, that would show the pleasure of God and the satisfaction of God. And there as Jesus is baptized, the Father interrupts the baptismal service and says, "This is My beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." Yeah. And that fragrance of obedience there to the will of God pleased the Father there at that beginning of the public ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's a good beginning. That's a good start. And concerning His public ministry, it was twofold, as we said last Sunday night, a ministry of provision and a ministry of illumination. His provisional ministry is seen there by that golden table of showbread. His ministry of illumination seen by that golden lampstand. And what we've seen in the life of Christ, according to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, is that He provided, He graciously provided food for the hungry. He provided cleansing for the lepers. He provided healing for the sick. He provided liberty for those that were oppressed by demons or unclean spirits. He provided forgiveness for the sinner, and He provided life for those that He raised up from the dead. But in His ministry of illumination, Christ came preaching about the kingdom of heaven, which is the literal, physical, earthly manifestation of the glory of God. And He came preaching also about the kingdom of God, which is the spiritual, personal manifestation of the glory of God. And Christ, as a teacher, He was also a preacher. And as a preacher, He was also a teacher. And His words were light. And that light shined. And men that were seeking after God, and men that were hungering after God, when the light went out, they came. But those that were looking for fault and those who were seeking to justify their sin, when the light went out, they justified themselves and they cursed the light. Jesus said they wouldn't come to Him because they hated the light. They wouldn't come because they hated the light. His words were light. And because of His words, the Holy Spirit informs us, they conspired against Him, how they may take Him and have Him crucified. So what did Christ do as He approaches His hour? Just highlighting His ministry there. 3.5 years of a ministry of provision and illumination. What does He do? As He approaches His hour, that is reference to His death, He takes His disciples off away from everyone. And He spends time with them. He's preparing them, as it were, there at the brazen laver. He's cleaning them up there, even so much as that He would tie on that towel, humble Himself, wash their feet, and speak these words to them: "Ye are clean by the word which I have spoken unto you." Then once He's prayed His high priestly prayer that's recorded in John chapter 17, He goes off to the Garden of Gethsemane and then off to Calvary. And that hour there that He spoke of, the hour of His suffering, the hour of His death, that is represented by that brass altar of sacrifice. And again, once Christ's flesh is torn and the blood begins to flow. And think about how early the blood would have begun to flow. Now, it would have been the only time that Christ would have begun to bleed. You know, see, you and I, we grew up stumping our toes and everything else, but not the Lord Jesus Christ. Not a bone of Him would be broken. He was protected of God up to this moment, that He would go into the Garden of Gethsemane and there feel the pressures of the weight of the sin of the world. And the Bible says He would sweat, as it were, great drops of blood. That's the beginning there at Gethsemane. He begins to give that blood, and then He goes off to Gabbatha. And there at Gabbatha's pavement, they'll beat Him and pluck the beard from His face, and they'll crown Him with a crown of thorns, and they'll whip Him with a Roman scourge. And then from Gabbatha, they take Him to Golgotha, and they crucify Him there, hanging by His hands and His feet. And He becomes sin who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. He dies in our place. He took what we deserved. He, by the grace of God, tasted death for every man. And there He breathes out His life's, He breathes out His life's breath and says, "It's finished." What was He referring to? Was He referring to His life? No, because 3 days later He'd get up from the dead. Because it wasn't possible that death could hold Him. Is He referring to His ministry? That couldn't be, because here we are on the back end of the world here 2,000 years later, the ministry of Christ is still doing good. What's He referring to? He's referring to the will that He came to perform of the Father when He came into the world. Lo, in the volume of the book it is written of Me, I am come to do Thy will, O God. And He comes down as a sacrifice, and He dies in our place so that we might be saved. Now, it's from that altar of sacrifice, that censer there, Christ would have symbolically picked up. Of course, He appears in heaven on our behalf, and there's the blood. He makes that eternal atonement, and the altar of incense now burned with a sacrifice. They're that sweet-smelling savor unto God, to the eternal pleasure and satisfaction of God. But Christ didn't stay in heaven there as He first appears there to the Father. The Bible shows us that He appears once again to His disciples. And He begins the process of proving Himself alive by many infallible proofs. That's the Bible word, amen? Infallible. You know, the other Bibles get it wrong. The King James Bible gets it right. It's infallible proofs. He proved beyond any shadow of a doubt He's alive. And then as He appears to them, it's just as if again, once again, He's got them there, just again in that upper room, just as He had done before, carefully preparing them. He shows them He's alive. He encourages them by His word. When He speaks the word to them, they said, our hearts burned within us when He opened to us the Scripture. And they're getting clean again. And He enters once again into that ministry of provision and that ministry of illumination, saying, have you got any fish? And He eats with them. I mean, He wasn't a spirit that rose from the dead. He got up bodily. He said, handle me and see that a spirit hath not flesh and bone as you see me have. And He fellowshipped with them and He provided there and that miracle of the fish that He brought in. And then also He spoke to them, the Bible says, for 40 days, teaching them things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And they were illuminated. And before He would ascend up again to be with God in their sight, He would, of course, breathe on them. And He would say, receive ye the Holy Ghost. A picture there of that altar of incense. Them serving there in that altar, serving and worshiping and praising God by the Holy Spirit. Here's what the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 21, as Christ would go back into the Holy of Holies in His ascension. It says, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, our bodies washed with pure water. What is the conclusion of the service of our high priest? He said this, let us draw near. Amen. I'm all for that. Amen. Snuggling up to the Lord, getting as close as I can get. Well, that veil there, that veil, think about it. The pattern of the veil. First, there's the cloth that was used. It's pure white linen. That's the cloth that's used. White linen in Revelation chapter 19, the Spirit of God says, represents righteousness. Amen. And in that point, as we think about Christ and His humanity there, it shows His purity, His innocence, His sinlessness. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 22, of our Savior, it says, who did no sin, neither was guile found in His mouth. Who when He was reviled, reviled not again. When He suffered, He threatened not. But He committed Himself to Him that judgeth righteously, who His own self bare our sins in His own body on the tree, that we being dead to sins should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you are healed. It also says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. That's Him, amen? White linen, pure, righteous, sinless, innocence. That's the Lord Jesus in His character. And then notice the not only the cloth, but the colors that are used to decorate the veil. Speaking of the beatings and the scourgings of Christ, Sister Katie and I were talking about how His visage was marred more than any man. And that means that you couldn't tell He was a man. And He was beaten blue and purple and of course shedding His scarlet blood. But specifically, the color blue speaks of Christ and His heavenly origin. And His coming down from the heavens. His coming down from heaven, from God the Father. The Bible says in Romans chapter 8, verse 3, for what the law could not do, and that it was weak through the flesh, God sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. Amen. I'm glad He came. I'm glad He came. Then there's the purple, which speaks of royalty. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 15 says, which in His times He shall show. Who is the blessed and only potentate? Amen. Amen. I know who that is. The King of kings, the Lord of lords, who only hath immortality, dwelling in the light which no man can approach unto, whom no man hath seen nor can see, to whom be honor and power everlasting. Amen. That's Paul's words. Then there's the scarlet that speaks of the sacrifice of Christ and the glory of His cross, as well as His precious blood. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 1, verse 5, unto Him that loved us and washed us from our sins in His own blood. Thank God for the precious blood of Christ. Something else to consider about this veil, along with the cloth and the colors, is the construction of the veil. Notice this cloth is said to be fine twined of cunning work. And that cloth had that special weave there, showing us both natures of Christ. I mean, it's obvious there as you study the record. If you're looking for the manhood of Christ, you can see His humanity. If you're looking for the deity of Christ, you can see His lordship. It's obvious that He's God manifest in the flesh. Both there in the weakness of a human body, at the same time, He's God in that human body. And you see, He's 100% man and He's 100% God. He possesses both nature, the divine nature and His own perfect human nature, which was sinless. Now you put all these things together there, the cloth, the colors, the construction of the veil. And here's the truths that are borne out there as going along with the four witnesses of the New Testament record, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Again, I remind you that Matthew speaks of Christ as King, the Son of David. Mark speaks of Christ as the suffering servant, which is prophesied in the book of Isaiah. Luke speaks of Christ as the perfect sinless man. And then John speaks of Christ as the Lord from heaven. Now Matthew's witness then is represented by the color of royalty, which is purple. And then Mark's witness is represented by the scarlet, which spoke of that suffering servant. Luke's witness is represented by the very material in the veil, which is that fine linen, white, fine linen, pure white, showing the sinlessness of Christ's humanity. And then the blue represents John's witness, showing him to be the Son of God, which came down from heaven to earth. That's the pattern of the veil. Next, there's the purpose of the veil. The purpose of the veil is it served as a warning. It served as a warning. The veil was between the holy place and the holy of holies. Every day, the other priest, and we've taken time to show you that the other priest of the tribe of Levi represents, in that Old Testament setting, we New Testament children of God. And the Spirit of God uses some truths about them to show us our service in bearing the tabernacle, which is Emmanuel, God with us, bearing His testimony throughout the world. That's our job. Our job is to bear the testimony of God with us throughout the world, just as those Levite priests did. Those Levite priests were given to the high priest as servants. The high priest was one man, and they were wholly given to him as his servants. The high priest is Jesus Christ. We are his servants. We're to serve him. In that tabernacle there, as far as the testimony is concerned, we're not in a literal tent or in the temple even, but we're a New Testament priesthood, a royal priesthood, the Bible says, given to Him as servants, and those men that served Him were able to serve in the outer court. As a matter of fact, hundreds did every day. And they were able to serve Him in the holy place. Hundreds did every day. But the high priest alone was allowed to go into the Holy of Holies. Only the high priest. They weren't allowed. And there, as that served as a warning there, it had cherubims embroidered on it, according to the Bible. Cherubims, of course, are used in the Bible to decorate and manifest the glory of God. That's what these heavenly creatures are designed to do. And that's a message to itself, but they also, in Genesis chapter 3, the very first mentioning of a cherub, is the one that stands outside the garden because of their sin. They're not allowed in. And he stands there with a sword that turns every way, circumspect, saying, you're not allowed in. You're not allowed any closer. That's the warning that comes from that veil there that was designed by the Lord. It serves as a warning saying, you can go no farther. No farther. Then it serves as a wall. Here's what Leviticus chapter 16, verse 2 says. It serves as a wall, a barrier between God and man, shutting man out from the presence of God. He said, the Lord said unto Moses, speak unto Aaron thy brother, that he come not at all times into the holy place within the veil before the mercy seat, which is upon the ark, that he die not. This is Aaron, the high priest. For I will appear in the cloud upon the mercy seat. Now, between the sinner and God, there's a great wall standing. If you've never been saved, there's a great separation. The separation is not because you don't go to church. That's not the separation. It's not because you've never been baptized in water. That's not the separation. It's not because there's a list of good things you've never done. That's not the separation. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 59 and verse 2, it's your sins. Your sins are in the way. And here's the situation. There's only one thing that can remove your sins. And that's the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. You can join the church. You can be baptized in water. You can start doing a whole list of good things that you think God would be pleased with. But it will not bring you into reconciliation with God. Not until your sins are removed by the blood of Jesus Christ. You know what that veil showed? It showed a wall. And it also showed a way. It served as a way. There on the Day of Atonement, the high priest could enter. That one day of the year, he could enter into the Holy of Holies, but only by the blood of the sacrificial lamb. Leviticus 16:15 says, "Then shall he kill the goat of the sin offering that is for the people, and bring his blood within the veil, and do with that blood as he did with the blood of the bullock, and sprinkle it upon the mercy seat and before the mercy seat." On that day there, he would go in and he would have to make sacrifice for himself. He'd have to sprinkle the ground there with the blood so that he could stand there. He'd have to take the smoke from off that censer there. He'd have to take it with him so that the smoke filled, lest he would look upon the glory of God and die. And then, of course, he would have to put the blood on the mercy seat, both for himself and for the people. Now, that veil served also as a witness. While the high priest could go in one day of the year into the Holy of Holies, it was only one day of the year. Now, that's a situation there that's been changed. Amen. Aren't you glad that you just don't get to worship God and be with God one day a year? I mean, I know some folks say, well, that's Christmas, or that's Easter, that's the day we go to church. But no, we can worship God, and we can walk with God and fellowship with Him every day. Why? Because the way is open. The way is open. That veil represented the pure, sinless nature, the absolute perfection, the divine royalty, the humble divine service of the Lord's servant, the Lord's King, and the Son of God Himself, and His purity, His sinlessness, His innocence. That's what that veil represented. And that veil was what stood in the way. That's what stood in the way. You know what the Bible says? It says, "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy might." Folks, it wouldn't matter how good we measure up next to one another. We haven't done that first and great commandment. We all fall short. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Some more than others, but we've all come short. Amen. But Jesus Christ, the perfect man, never came short. He fulfilled the law of God. He was completely obedient. Think about it. Every second of every day, of every week, of every month, of every year, for over 33 years, his mind, his heart went towards loving God, and all of his might went towards loving God. That's obvious. There comes a time there where he and his disciples want some rest. And so they're departing to Peter's house to get some rest. When they get there, the house is filled with people that need his help. Even Peter's mom is sick, and he has to tend to her. You know what he did? He stayed up there through the night, and he dealt with people, and he taught people, and he helped people. And then you know what happened the very next day? The Bible says in Luke chapter 6, "Rising a great while before day, he departed into a solitary place, and there he prayed." You and I would have slept in, but not him. You know why? All his might, all his heart, all his soul was towards obeying and pleasing God the Father. And he lived as a 33 and a half year old man and offered himself as a sacrifice. Why? Because we've come short of God's glory. Because we've sinned. And one day, that veil ran in twain from top to bottom. The parting of the veil, the method of its parting. Obviously, man didn't have anything to do with it. Man couldn't have anything to do with it. They say a team of horses couldn't have tore it the way it was torn. But the fact is, it was torn from top to bottom. Somebody from above tore it. That's the method of its parting. The message of its parting was crystal clear. Those old priests there that were never allowed in all their lifetime to even look into the Holy of Holies, though they were able to go into the outer court and into the holy place every day, they couldn't even sneak a peek into the Holy of Holies. And one day, God rent the veil, and they could see right into the Holy of Holies. The way was open. Anyone could go in there, there of the priesthood, and see. The Bible says in Hebrews 10:20, by a new and living way which He hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, His flesh. When Christ was punished in our place for our sins, the way was opened for us to press toward God and to be close to God. And that's the message of the majesty of its parting there. In Jesus, we can come before the Father anytime, anytime. Not just a day of atonement, not just a special day, but any day, every day, all day long, we can walk with God and spend time there before the Lord. Now, let me close. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. And you learn the Bible by connecting words. That's how the Holy Ghost teaches. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 13 says, which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth. Comparing spiritual things with spiritual things. He says, not in man's words, but in the words which the Holy Ghost teacheth. That's what he said. Comparing spiritual things with spiritual. Now, if we're able to understand the Bible and be taught the Bible by the Holy Ghost, we have to compare the words of the Holy Ghost with the words of the Holy Ghost. To compare spiritual things with spiritual. For example, the Ark of Noah was completely different from the Ark of bulrushes. That Moses was placed in, there into the river of the Nile, there to protect him as a young boy. But the Holy Ghost used the word ark in both places and does so for a purpose, so that we can make a connection. And we can learn some truth there. Moses being drawn out of the water, which is what the name Moses means. Drawn out of the water. The waters, the waters of judgment. And he's drawn out of the ark of bulrushes. He's in a place of safety that's in the waters of judgment, and he's drawn out of the place of safety, picturing the resurrection. That's what's shown. Drawn out of the waters of death, drawn out of the waters of judgment. That's what's illustrated there with Moses. And then we come to the Ark of Noah. It's completely different from that Ark of bulrushes. But again, there's a picture of a resurrection given there. A picture of a resurrection that signified there because it rested, found land atop of Mount Ararat, and did so on the 17th day of the 7th month. God put that bow in the sky, that token saying that He was satisfied. The waters of judgment had passed, and now He was satisfied. He was pleased when He smelled the sacrifice of Noah's sacrifice and offering that He made to Him there. And on the 17th day of the 7th month, those waters began to recede, and the judgment waters were passed away. Now that's important because in that same month, the 7th month, that's when the Passover lamb was offered later to come in the book of Exodus. The Passover lamb would be offered up on the 14th day of the 7th month. And Jesus Christ, we understand He's the Passover lamb. At the very time that they're offering up the Passover lamb, Jesus Christ, the Passover lamb, is being offered up by God. And then that's signified through the ceremony of the Passover lamb. And if someone wanted to know the truth about all this and sat down and began to study their Bible and comparing the words of the Holy Ghost, they would run back there some references and they would find out that on the 7th month, in the 17th day, that ark rested upon the Mount of Ararat after the judgment had passed. And God gave that token in the sky saying, I'm pleased. Judgment is past. Picture the resurrection. You say, how? Because the 17th day is 3 days from the 14th day. What's the gospel that we preach? It's Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that He was buried, and that He rose again the 3rd day according to the Scriptures. And so the gospel, it's in there over and over and over again. And we begin to see the witness of it repeating itself over and over again. And the Holy Ghost uses that word so that we'll make the connection to the truth of the resurrection. Now here the word veil is used. And it's making reference, Paul is, to something that happens in Exodus chapter 34. It's when Moses comes down from the mount. He's received the law. He's been with God. And because he's been with God, who is a consuming fire, he's pure energy, his countenance begins to shine. The Bible says in Exodus 34, his skin began to shine. And he shone so bright, he was so illuminated by the presence of God, men couldn't look at him. And he had to put a veil on so that men could even spend any time around him. Here in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 7 says, "But if the ministration of death, written and engraven in stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness succeed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect, by reason of the glory that excelleth. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious. Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech, and not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. But their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when it, the heart, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away." What he explains there for us, it's, again, it's a different veil, but it's the same word. And it served the same purpose. And there was a separation there.